disruption and played with that gun. And my friend kept playing with the gun, and he pointed the gun at me. I was sitting on the couch when he pointed the gun at me. I had my arm up, and I just saw the barrel of the gun light up. When I saw it, I heard the explosion, and I saw the light from when the gun exploded. So I grabbed my head, because it looked like from where he was standing that the bullet was going to hit me in my head. When I grabbed my head, the bullet went under my arm. So immediately, the bullet touched a nerve on my spine, so I fell back on the couch, and my arm just fell, and then I started feeling funny. So my legs start feeling numb, like when your arm go to sleep or something, so I start hitting my legs. And I was like, he dropped the gun, and I was like, you shot me. He was like, stop playing. So then my brother was saying, I told y'all stop playing, that's why I told you stop playing. So he kept saying, you know, stop playing. So at that moment, I'm thinking, you know, we might get arrested, we might get in trouble, something like that. So I wanted to get out the house, but when I went to get up, I realized I couldn't move. So it like instantly paralyzed me, so I kept hitting my legs because they just felt numb and they felt like rubbery. So when I said, look, you shot me, I need to get out of here, I gotta get to the hospital. So he picked me up, and we was on a fifth floor building, so he started carrying me down the steps. While he was carrying me down the steps, you know, we made it outside to the street, and then, you know, I was kind of heavy for him, so we struggling going down the street. We stopped a cab, and when we stopped the cab, he wouldn't let me get in the car because he was wondering why is he carrying me. Once he realized, I ended up telling the cab driver, I said, look, I broke my leg. So he let me get in the cab. We took the cab to Lincoln Hospital. On my ride to the cab, I kept going in and out of conscious because what happened when the bullet was so hot, when it went through my side, it melted the skin back close, and the blood started filling both of my lungs up. So as my lungs filled up, I started losing my breath and I was losing conscious. So I went out a few times and I felt him just hit me like, no, no, wake up, wake up. So now, you know, I'm coming in and out of conscious, and I'm sitting in the middle, my brother's on the other side of me. My brother's kind of like traumatized from the whole thing. He's kind of quiet and just like can't believe what just happened. So now my friend is trying to keep me conscious because he's thinking, like, I don't want you to die. So now on the ride to the cab, you know, we're trying to decide. So my friend's like, you know, please don't tell him, you know. And then growing up in the South Bronx, growing up in the street where we have this code of not snitching, you know, I honored it in the fact that, look, I'm not going to tell on you. You know, I just want to get to the hospital. So, you know, we decided when we get there, so look, we came up with this story. We don't just tell the cops that, you know, I was outside, somebody was shooting, and I got hit. So when we got to the hospital, and the detective came in, when we got to the hospital door, I completely collapsed. So when I passed out, I woke up again. I was in the OR, and I just saw the lights in the operating room, and they was basically they cut a hole in my side so they could put a hose in and drain my lungs so I could breathe again. And I remember hearing my mother walk past the hall. She was coming down the hall, and she was screaming down the hall, who shot my son. And she saw me, and she saw the bullet hole in my side. So she's screaming, you know, who shot my son. So as I just turned my head, because I really didn't want to answer no questions, because I didn't even want to talk to her. I felt like, what am I telling her? So as two detectives came in the room and they asked me what happened, so I went with the story. I was outside, somebody shot me. You know, they were shooting, I got hit, and I gave them a description of some guy. So they went looking for the guy. So then my mother saw my brother and my friend in the hallway, and then the detective went to my mother and said, she was like, you know, who shot him? Like, what happened? So the detective said, the story not making sense, because two of them said he was outside, one of them said he was in the building. So at that point, they realized that, you know, one of them may have done it. And now they telling my mother, I think one of them did it. So my mother's like, no, they couldn't have did it, because that's his brother and that's his best friend. So eventually, my mother went to my brother and said, listen, I don't care about the code in the street. I want to know who shot my son. Who shot your brother? So my brother ended up telling my mother my friend did. So then at that point, they tried to lock my brother and my friend up to figure out who did it. So my mother dropped the charges. We ended up letting my friend go. And that point, my mother just walked back to the room to make sure I was okay. So she asked the doctor, you know, what was my diagnosis, and pretty much told her, you know, he would never be able to sit up again. He has a 1% chance to live, I mean to walk again. So at that point, because both of my lungs had collapsed and I was fighting for my life, my mother had just lost my brother maybe 5 years before that. My brother died when he was 6 months old. So the trauma she had already been dealing with, and then you have another child that's fighting for his life. My mother at that point, it wasn't even important to her whether I walked or not. It was more like just saving life. So I eventually recovered, and you know, during that period that I was in the hospital is why I'm so touched to see y'all here today as nurses, because my first encounter with dealing with my situation was with my nurse. You know, her coming in the room and me saying to my nurse, where at that point, all I could do was lay down and look at the ceiling. I couldn't move. And because of the bullet was lodged in my spine, but it was sitting behind my heart, they didn't immediately go in and get the bullet out, and it was a 22 caliber bullet, so they were scared that the bullet would fall in my heart. And once if the bullet fell in my heart, I would die. So I pretty much laid there motionless for maybe 4 straight months, just looking at the ceiling and, you know, dealing with my nurses coming in every day.